Hello everyone. In this video, we will talk about the book Good Strategy, Bad Strategy, The Difference and Why It Matters by Richard Rumelt. So, in a nutshell, a strategy is like a lever that magnifies force. Yes, one can drag a giant block of rock across the ground with muscles, rope and motivation, but it is wiser to build levers and wheels and then move the rock. At the time of making this video, the world is fighting COVID-19. When such changes occur, most people focus on the main effects. Falling demand, for example. One must dig beneath this surface reality to understand the forces underlying the main effect and develop a point of view about the second order and derivative changes that have been set into motion. Working with industry-wide or economy-wide change may even be more advanced than particle physics. Understanding and predicting patterns of these dynamics is very difficult. Fortunately, a leader does not need to get it totally right. The organization's strategy merely has to be more right than those of its rivals. Now, let us look at what is good strategy and what is bad strategy. Beginning with good strategies, a strategy is like a lever that magnifies force. So, a talented leader identifies the one or two critical issues in the situation, the pivot points that can multiply the effectiveness of effort, and then focuses and concentrates action and resources on them. And greater the challenge, the more a good strategy focuses and coordinates efforts to achieve a powerful competitive punch or problem-solving effect. The term strategy should mean a cohesive response to an important challenge. Unlike a standalone decision or a goal, a strategy is a coherent set of analysis, concepts, policies, arguments, and actions that respond to a high-stakes challenge. So, how to move forward? Strategy is about how an organization will move forward. Doing strategy is figuring out how to advance the organization's interest. Of course, a leader can set goals and delegate it to others the job of figuring out what to do, but that is not strategy. So, looking at bad strategies, bad strategy tends to skip over irritating details such as problems. It ignores the power of choice and focus, trying instead to accommodate a multitude of conflicting demands and interests. Like a quarterback whose only advice to teammates is, "Let's win." Bad strategy covers up its failure to guide by embracing the language of broad goals, ambitions, vision, and values. Many people assume that a strategy is a big picture, overall direction, divorced from any specific action. But defining strategy as broad concepts, thereby leaving out action, creates a wide rift between strategy and implementation. When the strategy process is basically a game of setting performance goals, so much market share, so much profit, etc., then there remains a big gap between these ambitions and actions. If that is how an organization runs, let's be honest and call it goal setting and not strategy. Coming back to good strategy again, a good strategy has an essential logical structure that Mr. Rumelt calls the kernel. The kernel of a strategy contains three elements: a diagnosis, a guiding policy, and a coherent action. The guiding policy specifies the approach to dealing with the obstacles called out in the diagnosis. It is like a signpost marking the direction forward, but not defining the details of the trip. Coherent actions are feasible, coordinated policies, resource commitment, and actions designed to carry out the guiding policy. Now look at bad strategy. Bad strategy is having multiple goals and initiatives that symbolize progress, but no coherent action, coherent approach to accomplish that progress other than spend more and try harder. Man-made disasters like aftermath of Katrina or the BP Gulf oil spill and many others were the result of 5 intertwined errors in human judgment and behavior, which are engineering overreach, smooth sailing fallacy, risk-seeking incentives, social herding, and finally the inside view. The details of these errors I will not cover in this video. In the book, they are given in detail. In an example in the book, author talks about how during the Cold War, the traditional budget cycle of the military and the Congress had created a reactive mindset. Each year, the Joint Chiefs developed an assessment of the Soviet threat, which was essentially an estimate of their present and planned weapon inventories. The Pentagon developed responses to the threats that amounted to a shopping list. Congress would appropriate some fraction of what was requested and the cycle would begin again. We see such kind of cycle in other countries as well. Budget cycle, for example, in India, different ministries would give their requests and the central government would compile them and make a list of budget. Or in a company, different departments may give their request for budget and the management would compile the request and pass some and compile a list of a shopping list kind of. So coming back, the pathway to a bad strategy is a template style strategy. The current fill in the blanks template starts with a statement of vision, then mission statement or a list of core values, then a list of strategic goals, then for each goal a list of strategies, then finally a list of initiatives. This path offers a one-size-fits-all substitute for the hard work of analysis and coordinated action. If you would like to know more about this type of bad strategy, I had created a video as well as a template which is available on my website. I would not recommend this, but people want this, and so I had prepared a template. This is a very popular method of bad strategy followed all over the world. Coming back to good strategy, so the kernel of strategy contains 3 elements: a diagnosis that defines or explains the nature of the challenge, a good diagnosis simplifies the often overwhelming complexity of reality by identifying certain aspects of the situation as critical. A guiding policy is an overall approach chosen to cope with or overcome the obstacles identified in the diagnosis. A set of coherent actions are designed to carry out the guiding policy. These are steps that are coordinated with one another to work together in accomplishing the guiding policy. So, looking at diagnosis, first step is understanding the situation. An especially insightful diagnosis can transform one's view of the situation, bringing a radically different perspective to bear. When a diagnosis classifies the situation as a certain type, it opens access to knowledge about how analogous situations were handled in the past. An explicit diagnosis permits one to evaluate the rest of the strategy. the diagnosis for the situation should replace the overwhelming complexity of reality with a simpler story. A story that calls attention to its crucial aspects. This simplified model of reality allows one to make sense of the situation and engage in further problem solving. The guiding policy outlines an overall approach for overcoming obstacles highlighted in the diagnosis. It is guiding because it channels actions in certain directions without defining exactly what should be done. Like the guardrails of a highway, a guiding policy directs and constrains action without fully defining its content. Good guiding policies are not goals or visions or images of desirable end states. Rather, they define a method of grappling with the situation and ruling out a vast array of possible actions. One doesn't go directly from diagnosis to action, but rather outline an overall approach. A guiding policy creates advantage by anticipating the actions and reactions of others, by reducing the complexity and ambiguity in the situation, by exploiting the leverage inherent in concentrating effort on a pivotal or decisive aspect of the situation, and by creating policies and actions that are coherent, each building on the other rather than cancelling one another out. Now looking at coherent action, many people call the guiding policy the strategy and stop there. This is a mistake. Strategy is about action, about doing something. The kernel of strategy must contain action. It does not need to point to all the actions that will be taken as events unfold, but there must be enough clarity about action to bring concepts down to earth. The actions within the kernel of strategy should be coherent. That is, the resource deployment, the policies, maneuvers that are undertaken should be consistent and coordinated. The coordination of action provides the most basic source of leverage or advantage available in the strategy. An example of simplest business strategy given in the book is to use knowledge gleaned by sales and marketing specialists to affect capacity expansion or product design decisions. Coordination across functions and knowledge bases. Strategy coordinates action to address a specific challenge. It is not defined by the pay grade of the person authorizing the action. The idea that coordination by itself can be a source of advantage is a very deep principle. It is often underappreciated because people tend to think of coordination in terms of continuing mutual adjustments among agents. Strategic coordination or coherence is not ad hoc mutual adjustment. It is coherence imposed on a system by policy and design. More specifically, design is the engineering of fit among parts, specifying how actions and resources will be combined. Now let us get back to good strategy and bad strategy. Looking at things from a different or fresh perspective can reveal new realms of advantage and opportunity, as well as weakness and threat. It is the victory of apparent weakness over apparent strength that gives it this tail its bite. There is actual discovery of power in a situation, the creation or revelation of a decisive asymmetry. Not every good strategy draws on this kind of insight, but those that do generate the extra kick that separates ordinary excellence from the extraordinary. In a separate video, I talk about advantage SWOT, which you can look up for more details. Many people get confused between goals and objectives. To help clarify this distinction, it is helpful to use the word goal to express overall values and desires, and to use the word objective to denote specific operational targets. Thus, a country may have goals of freedom, justice, peace, security, and happiness. We talked about this in bad strategy in previous slide. It is strategy which transforms these vague overall goals into a coherent set of actionable objectives. A leader's most important job is creating and constantly adjusting this strategic bridge between goals and objectives. Proximate objectives. By proximate, it means a state of affairs close enough at hand to be feasible. If an objective is clear and feasible, it can help coordinate both problem solving and direct action. Strategy is visible as coordinated action imposed on a system. Good strategy and good organization lie in specializing on the right activities and imposing only the essential amount of coordination. The focus channeled at the right moment onto a pivotal objective can produce a cascade of favorable outcomes. It is just like a knockout punch in a boxing match. Author calls this source of power leverage. Finding such crucial pivot points and concentrating force on them is the secret of strategic leverage. In general, strategic leverage arises from a mixture of anticipation, insight into what is most pivotal or critical in a situation, and making a concentrating application of effort. Not talking about bad strategy, there are four different ways the author has talked about. First one is fluff. It is a form of gibberish masquerading as a strategic concept or argument. It uses Sunday words that are inflated or unnecessary obtuse, and apparently esoteric concepts. To create the illusion of high-level thinking, fluff is superficial restatement of the obvious combined with generous sprinkling of buzzwords. Fluff masquerades as expertise, thought, and analysis. Unfortunately, MBA teaches this, and we see this in corporate websites and presentations. If you look around, there is so much fluff. Second one is failure to face a challenge. Bad strategy fails to recognize or define the challenge. When you cannot define a challenge, you cannot evaluate a strategy or improve it. Third one, which we also talked earlier, mistaking goals for strategy. Many bad strategies are just statements of desire rather than plans for overcoming obstacles. And finally, bad strategic objectives. We talked about proximate objectives. Now we'll talk about bad strategic objectives. A strategic objective is a set by a leader as a means to an end. Strategic objectives are bad when they fail to address critical issues or when they are impracticable. In the book, example of blue sky objective is given, which is usually a simple restatement of the desired state of affairs or of the challenge. It skips over the annoying fact that no one has a clue as to how to get there. A leader may successfully identify the key challenge and propose an overall approach to dealing with the challenge, but if the consequent strategic objectives are also blue sky, not much has been achieved. The purpose of good strategy is to offer a potentially achievable way of surmounting a key challenge. If the leader's strategic objectives are just as difficult to accomplish as the original challenge, there has been little value added by the strategy. Many writers on strategy seem to suggest that the more dynamic the situation, the farther ahead a leader must look. This is illogical. The more dynamic the situation, the poorer your foresight will be. again it brings back to the topic of coronavirus. The situation is so dynamic, one can't predict long into future. Therefore, the more uncertain and dynamic the situation, the more proximate a strategic objective should be. Now let's get back to good strategy. Strategy is hard work. Serious strategy work is in an already successful organization may not take place until the wolf is at the door, or even until the wolf's claws actually scratch on the floor, because good strategy is very hard work. Strategy involves focus and therefore choice. And choice means setting aside some goals in favor of others. When this hard work is not done, weak, amorphous strategy is the result. This is difficult psychological, political, and organizational work in saying no to whole worlds of hopes, dreams, and aspirations. When a strategy works, we tend to remember what was accomplished, not the possibilities that were painfully set aside. Only the prospect of choice inspires people's best arguments about the pluses of their own proposals and the negatives of others. An important duty of any leader is to absorb a large part of the complexity and ambiguity in an organization and passing on to the organization a simpler problem, one that is solvable. Many leaders fail badly at this responsibility, announcing ambitious goals without resolving a good chunk of ambiguity about the specific objectives, specific obstacles to be overcome. To take responsibility is more than willingness to accept the blame. It is setting proximate objectives and handling the organization a problem it can actually solve. The leader's responsibility is to decide which of the pathways will be most fruitful and design a way to marshal the organization's knowledge, resources, energy to that end. Importantly, opportunities, challenges, and changes don't come along in nice annual packages. The need for true strategy work is episodic and not necessarily annual. So one must rethink their annual strategic plans. Let's go to bad strategy. Bad strategy flourishes because it floats over analysis, logic, and choice, held aloft by the hope that one can avoid dealing with these tricky fundamentals and difficulties of mastering them. Not miscalculation. Bad strategy is active avoidance of hard work of crafting a good strategy. Another pathway to bad strategy is new thought, the belief that all you need to succeed is a positive mental attitude. One common reason for choosing avoidance is the pain or difficulty of choice. When leaders are unwilling or unable to make choices among competing values and parties, bad strategy is the consequence. When organizations are unable to make new strategies, when people evade work of choosing among different paths into the future, then you get vague goals that everyone can agree on. Such goals are direct evidence of leadership's insufficient will or political power to make or enforce hard choices. Put differently, universal buy-in usually signals absence of choice. Also, a change in strategy will make some people worse off. Hence, there will be powerful forces opposed to almost any change in strategy. This is the fate of many strategy initiatives in larger organizations. There may be talk about focusing on this or pushing on that, but at the end of the day, no one wants to change what they are doing very much. A long list of things to do, often mislabeled as strategies or objectives, is not a strategy. It is just a long list of things to do. Such lists usually grow out of planning meetings in which a wide variety of stakeholders make a suggestion as to things they would like to see done. Rather than focus on few important points, the group sweeps the whole day of collection into a strategic plan. Nice strategic meet and at the end of the day, one collects a list of things to do. Then labor long term is added so that none of them needs to be done today. Now, coming back to leadership. Leaders inspire and motivate self-sacrifice. Change, for example, requires painful adjustment. As we just saw, no one wants change. A good leadership helps people feel more positively about making those adjustments. It is often said that strategy is a choice or decision. The word choice or decision evoke an image of someone considering a list of alternatives and then selecting one of them. Many effective strategies are more designs than decisions, are more constructed than chosen. For example, doing strategy is more like designing a high performance aircraft than deciding which forklift truck to buy or how large to build a new factory. When someone says managers are decision makers, they are not talking about master strategist, for a master strategist is a designer. Strategy is the craft of figuring out which purposes are both worth pursuing and capable of being accomplished. Master strategist is a designer. Author describes strategy as a design rather than as a plan or a choice because he wants to emphasize the issue of mutual adjustment in design problems, where various elements must be arranged, adjusted and coordinated. There can be sharply peaked gains to getting combination right and sharp cost to getting them wrong. A good strategy coordinates policies and cross activities to focus the competitive punch. As we talked about template style strategy earlier, consultants like template style strategy. It frees them from the onerous work of analyzing the true challenges and opportunities faced by a client. Plus, by couching strategy in terms of positives, vision, mission, values, no feelings are hurt. Most corporate strategic plans are simply 3-year or 5-year rolling budgets combined with a market share projection. Calling a rolling budget of this type a strategic plan gives people false expectations that the exercise will somehow result in a coherent strategy. There is nothing wrong with planning. It is an essential part of management. This is what is called resource plan. It makes sure resources arrive when they are needed and helps management detect surprises. You can call these annual exercises strategic planning if you want, but they are not strategy. They cannot deliver what senior managers want, a pathway to substantially higher performance. To obtain a higher performance, leaders must identify the critical obstacles to forward progress and then develop a coherent approach to overcoming them. If you would like to know more about strategic planning, do look up my video on strategic planning and template for the same. To make good bets on how a wave of change will play out, you must acquire enough expertise to question the experts. As changes begin to occur, the air will be full of comments about what is happening, but you must be able to dig beneath that surface and discover the fundamental choices at work. Leaders who stay above the details may do well in stable times, but riding a wave of change requires an intimate feel of its origins and dynamics. In COVID times, this is very important not to miss the details. It is in moments of industry transition that skills at strategy are most valuable. In moments of transition, the old pecking order of competitors may be upset and a new order becomes possible. There is no simple theory or framework for analyzing waves of change. Another bad example of bad strategy is setting targets. We've talked about it many times. The example goal of grow by 50% is a classic bad strategy. It is the kind of nonsense that passes for strategy in too many companies. First, it is setting goal, not designing a way to deal with his company's challenge. Second, a growth is the outcome of a successful strategy, and attempts to engineer growth are exercises in magical thinking. Good strategy bug again. Are you serious about strategy work? Then you must always do your own analysis. A strategy is not necessarily what the CEO intended or what some executives say it is. Sometimes they are hiding the truth, sometimes they are misstating it, and sometimes they have taken a position as a leader without really knowing the reasons for their company's success. Author says, how can we independently identify company's strategy? We do this by looking at each policy of the company and noticing those that are different from the norm in the industry. We then try to figure out the common target of such distinctive policies, what they are coordinated on accomplishing. Strategies focus resources, energy, and attention on some objectives rather than others. A particular pattern attacking a segment of the market with a business system supplying more value to that segment than the other players can is called focus. The word focus has two meanings. First, it denotes the coordination of policies that produces extra power through their interacting and overlapping effects. Second, it denotes the application of that power to right target. If the business is really successful, then there is usually a good strategic logic behind that success, be it hidden or not. But the truth is that many companies, especially large complex or companies, don't really have strategies. At the core, strategy is about focus, and most complex organizations don't focus their resources. Instead, they pursue multiple goals at once, not concentrating enough resources to achieve a breakthrough in any of them. The deep meaning of focus, concentration and coordination of action and resources that creates an advantage. Healthy growth is not engineered. It is the outcome of growing demand for special capabilities or of expanded or extended capabilities. It is the outcome of a firm having superior products and skills. It is the reward for successful innovation, cleverness, efficiency, and creativity. This kind of growth is not just an industrial phenomena. It normally shows up as a gain in market share that is simultaneous with superior rate of profit. Let's look at one of the bad strategies of engineering growth by acquisition. The problem with engineering growth by acquisition is that when you buy a company, especially a public company, you usually pay too much. You pay a premium over its ordinary market value, say 25% plus fee. If you have friendly investment bankers and lenders, you can grow as fast as you like by acquisition. But unless you can buy companies for less than they are worth, or unless you are specially positioned to add more value to the target than anyone else can, no value is created by expansion. Corporate leaders seek growth for many reasons. They may believe that administrative cost will fall with size. A poor but common reason for acquisitions is to move key executives to the periphery rather than let them go. The leaders of larger firms tend to be paid more. and in a decentralized company, making acquisition is a lot more fun than reading reports on divisional performance. In addition to all these reasons, key corporate advisors, investment bankers, consultants, mergers and acquisition law firms, and anyone who can claim a finder's fee can earn a king's ransom by being helpful in a major deal. Now let's get back to good strategy. Strategy is like chess or military affairs. It is about improving your position. If we look at an example from chess given in the book, two masters trying to defeat each other in a chess game during a large part of the game, likely to be making moves that have no immediate end other than improve my position. One does not win a chess game by always selecting moves that are directly aimed at trying to mate the opponent or even trying to win a particular piece. For the most part, the aim of the move is to find positions for one's piece that increase their mobility, that is, increase the options available to them and decrease the freedom of operation of the opponent pieces, impose certain relative stable patterns on the board that induce enduring strength for oneself and enduring weakness for the opponent. If and when sufficient positional advantages have been accumulated, they generally can be cashed in with greater or less ease by tactical maneuvers against specific targets that are no longer defensible or only at terrible cost. As we saw in chess, in strategy, premeditation is important. Judgment or anticipation concerning the thoughts and or behaviors of others is another important factor. And purposeful design, a design that is about fitting various pieces together so that they work as a coherent whole, constitute a good strategy. Now let's look at bad strategy. A strong resource position may seem like a good strategy, but it can obviate the need for sophisticated design type strategy. If instead there is only a moderate resource position, perhaps a new product idea or a customer relationship, the challenge is to build a sensible and coherent strategy around that resource. Finally, the cleverest strategies, the ones we study down through the years, begin with very few strategic resources, obtaining their results through the adroit coordination of actions in time across functions. The peril of potent resource position is that success then arrives without careful ongoing strategy work. Own the original patent on the plain paper photocopier, or own the Hershey's brand name or the Windows operating system, and there will be many years during which profits will roll in almost regardless of how you arrange your business logic. Yes, there was inventive genius in the creation of these strategic resources, but profits from those resources can be sustained for a time without genius. Well-led firms must from time to time cast aside old resources just as they retire obsolete machinery. There is no direct connection between current actions and current results. Were there such simple direct connection between current actions and current results, strategy would be a lot easier. It would also be less interesting, for it is the disconnect between current actions, current results, and current action that makes the analysis of the resources of the sources of success so hard and ultimately so rewarding. When the profits roll in, the leaders will point to their every action with pride. Books will be written recommending that others immediately adopt the successful firm's dress code, its vacation policy, its suggestion box policy and its method of allocating parking spaces, for example. You must have seen many books about successful companies like these. Of course, these connections are inaccurate. Let's look at two concepts, inertia and entropy, which you would come across, which are very important if you are doing strategy work. Starting with inertia, even with engines, even with its engines on hard reverse, a super tanker can take 1 mile to come to a stop. This property of mass, resistance to a change in motion, is inertia. In business, inertia is an organization's unwillingness or inability to adapt to changing circumstances. Even with change programs running at full throttle, it can take many years to alter a large company's basic functioning. Were organizational inertia the whole story, a well-adapted corporation would remain healthy and efficient as long as the outside world remained unchanged. But another force, entropy, is also at work. Organizational inertia generally falls into one of three categories: inertia of routine, cultural inertia, and inertia by proxy. Inertia by routine. An organization of some size and age rests on layer upon layer of impacted knowledge and experience, encapsulated in routines, the way things are done. These routines not only limit action to the familiar, they also filter and shape managers' perception of issues. An organization's standard routine and methods act to preserve old ways of categorizing and processing information. The inertia created by standard routines can be revealed by sudden outside shocks. The shock changes the basic basis of competition in the industry, creating a significant gap between the old routines and the need for of the new regime. Inertia due to obsolete and inappropriate routines can be fixed. The barriers are the perception of top management. If senior leaders become convinced that new routines are essential, change can be quick. The standard instruments are hiring managers from firms using better methods, acquiring a firm with superior methods, using consultants, or simply redesigning firms' routines. In any of these cases, it will probably be necessary to replace people who have invested many years developing and using the obsolete methods, as well as to reorganize business units around new patterns of information flow. Now let's look at culture. We use the word culture to mark the elements of social behavior and meaning that are stable and strongly resist change. The first step in breaking organizational culture inertia is simplification. And many further steps have been given in the book about how to change, how to tackle cultural inertia. Third one, a lack of response is not always an indication of sticky routines or a frozen culture. A business may choose to not respond to change or attack because responding would undermine still valuable streams of profit. Those streams of profit persist because of their customers' inertia, a form of inertia by proxy. So sometimes you don't want to change because customers don't want to change. That is form of inertia by proxy. Inertia by proxy disappears when the organization decides that adapting to a changed circumstances is more important than hanging on to old profit streams. Let's look at entropy. In science, let us define. Entropy measures a physical system's degree of disorder. The second law of thermodynamics states that entropy always increases in an isolated physical system. Similarly, weakly managed organizations tend to become less organized and focused. Entropy makes it necessary for leaders to constantly work on maintaining an organization's purpose, form, and methods, even if there are no changes in strategy or competition. With the passage of time, great works of art blur and crumble, the original intent fading, unless the skillful restorers do their work. One can sense a business firm that has not been carefully managed. Its product line grows less focused, prices are set low to please the sales department, shipping schedules are too long, pleasing only the factory, profits are taken home as bonuses to executives whose only accomplishment is outdoing the executive next door in internal competition over the bounty of luck and history. But entropy is a great boon to management and strategy consultants. This is the bread and butter of every consultant. Despite all the high-level concepts consultants advertise, the bread and butter of every consultant's business is undoing entropy, cleaning up the debris and weeds that grow in every organization's garden. So let's go to next slide. We'll look at good strategy and bad strategy again. In this slide, I'll not talk about all the concepts I've written here. I will quickly move to this point. In complex systems, there are no true or false answers. Complex logical systems are incomplete, that is, they contain statements and propositions that cannot be judged true or false within the logic of the system. To judge their truth, one must look beyond the system to outside knowledge. Human systems are complex systems, and there is no true or false answer. Strategy, again, battles with this kind of system. It's like science. Science is hypothesis, data, anomaly, the new hypothesis, data, and so on. It is called scientific induction. Strategy is similar. You have hypothesis, you have then you find out through data, you find out the problem, then you design a way to tackle it, you test it, and then you move on to next hypothesis. Coming to bad strategy, and this I will talk about, I'll directly go to the last point. You see, but you do not observe. If you have seen Sherlock Holmes series, Sherlock Holmes says to Watson, "You see, but you do not observe." The anomalies are not in nature, but in mind of the acute observer, revealed by comparison between the facts and refined expectations. So we come to the end of this video. Good strategy, bad strategy. So while comparing Sherlock Holmes to Watson, we can decide who we want to be. Let us conclude with some final thoughts. To guide your strategy, guide your thinking in strategy work, you must cultivate three essential skills or habits. First, you must have a variety of tools for fighting your own myopia and for guiding your attention. Second, you must develop the ability to question your own judgment. If you If your reasoning cannot withstand a vigorous attack, or your strategy cannot be expected to stand in the face of real competition. Third, you must cultivate the habit of making and recording judgments so that you can improve. The kernel, the basic concept in this book, is a list reminding us that a good strategy has a minimum three essential components: a diagnosis, the choice of an overall guiding policy, and the design of coherent action. It's the bare bone minimum what one must do. Being strategic is being less myopic, less short-sighted than others. You must perceive and take into account what others do not, be they colleagues or rivals. Being less myopic is not the same as pretending you can see the future. You must work with the facts on the ground, not the vague outlines of the distant future, whether it is the insight into industry structures and trends and anticipating the actions and reactions of competitors, insights into your own competencies and resources, or stretching your own thinking to cover more of the bases and resist your own biases. Being strategic largely means being less myopic than your own thoughtless self. This is a book summary, and so I have taken quotes directly from the book as it is. Book has a lot more details. Do go through it if you are serious in strategy work. Thank you.